Swami, welcome to the Indian Meditative Practices. This is actually session 4 of a summer series that started on Memorial Day and plans to go on right through summer until Labor Day. We have several masters and experts who will be joining us over the course of summer to share their particular tradition and introduce us to a practice from their tradition. So the entire session goes on Mondays and Wednesdays at 7 to 8. And of course, you can access it live through facebook.com/India and USA. And you'll have the opportunity to review it anytime you need at your leisure too. This is my background. I'm Aparna Ramaswamy. Professionally, I'm a clinical mental health counselor in Maryland and Washington, D.C. area. I also am a counselor educator. I'm a senior lecturer in the Johns Hopkins University in their counseling program. My area of expertise and research has been around Bharatanatyam, which is classical Indian dancing, yoga, specifically the Yoga Sutras and Ashtanga Yoga. And of course, I have a second doctorate in how do counselors and healthcare providers benefit by being meditators. I also have the blessing of being a Bharatanatyam dancer and teacher, trained the Dhananjayans in India. And more recently, I teach the Sunday program, the Family Dharma class at Sri Shiva Vishnu Temple in Greenbelt, Maryland. This is kind of what we have in store for you right through summer. Some of it has already happened and some of it is on tap. Some dates may get moved around, but you may want to take a picture of this. And of course, if you need to refer to this anytime, you can always look at our Facebook page to try and understand when what is scheduled. So the larger focus and structure of the whole session, the Indian meditative practices, is looking at what are the various traditions we have in India, what are some modern practices we have, when did they develop, where did they develop, how did they come to be, who were the people involved in it, what specifically are the differences and similarities between these traditions, and that is the larger structure of it. Each session is formatted in such a way that there is an initial component, which is guided relaxation, meditation, music, which oftentimes I will lead. And then every session has an educational component. So there is an experiential practice component. Let's say you're coming back home from work and you're ready to just relax. Great, just jump on in and you'll be able to do the guided relaxation. If you're catching it on your mobile phone, you're not able to actually meditate at that point, you kind of see what is there, understand what the session is about, maybe utilize the educational part of it, which comes in at 7:30, around 7:30, and at a later time between sessions, during the daytime, in the morning, weekends, you go back and reference it. There are a few ways you can access all of our sessions. Of course, one, you come in on facebook.com/IndianUSA for a live feed. You can watch it anytime on a very dedicated channel, which is facebook.com/healingtradition. You can also see it on YouTube on Ramaswami Aparna. There are a couple of playlists that are available to you. This entire series is being created as a playlist, and that is, of course, as a title of this program, Indian Meditative Practices. There is a second playlist that has been developed, which is guided meditation. The music that is used in this program, any kind of guided relaxation, is also populated there. So if you like a particular session, you have the option of going and using these at any time so that you're able to build that meditative muscle beyond just showing up and watching the program, which is great. Also, developing a meditative practice, which is one of our goals. My desire for each viewer is twofold. One is to develop a meditative practice, a regular meditative practice, by your own preference, whatever works for you, and we'll cover a variety of things. The second is to understand the context of meditation, not just in Indian meditative practices, but in the larger system of why we meditate. We've been covering some of it in the previous shows. If you've missed it, no worries. You can go look at it anytime, or we'll be covering it periodically through the entire session. So when it comes to music, I use the music of Mr. Raman Kalyan, who is based in Virginia. He's a composer, performer, educator, a brilliant musician. That is his website, ramankalyan.com. He also has an organization, the IAACM, based in Northern Virginia, which is dedicated to promoting Carnatic music. You can take lessons from him. You can hear his melodies. You can download them, buy them. He has a lot of resources available for people if they want to use music as a way of meditating, which is my preferred way oftentimes. So what is in tap for today? We start off with about a 15 some minutes of a guided meditation, which is finding the quiet amidst the chaos. It's not necessarily just the chaos is external in terms of environmental situational problems that are going on in the world, in our family, in our communities, at work, but also the inner chaos, conflict. We have emotions, we have reactions. We're not always able to regulate our anxiety or stress. We know what we have to do, but we're not able to do it. So kind of developing that ability to tap into that quiet, even amidst chaos. So that's a guided meditation. We then have a segment of music that will be played, which is what Mr. Raman Kalyan has specially choreographed for us. This is not available externally. This is a specially choreographed number, which is a video recording of Mr. Raman Kalyan's music. And then the focus, the guest presentation for today and two more sessions is traditional and science-based introduction to meditation. We have Dr. Stephen Parker, whose spiritual initiated name is Stoma. So we'll hear more about him as we go in through the session. So now on to the first part of our session. You know, the easiest thing people tell you is meditate. And there's a joke that goes on. If it was that easy to do, we would do it all the time. And when we sit down to meditate, even for the most experienced meditators, there are times when you sit down and your brain won't shut off. You're not able to stop thinking about something else. The most brilliant ideas come up at that time. You have your grocery list, your to-do list that you want to develop, or your body is hurting, the phone rings, somebody is bothering you. There is all of that. When the inside is quiet, the outside oftentimes is not. So how do we find that pocket of time when we can settle ourselves, refocus, no matter what time of the day or night it is? So this is a guided meditation, which is a 6-minute long meditation to prepare your body and your mind to meditate. It isn't like a switch that you can flip and say, okay, I'm going to meditate. You almost have a protocol, a ritual, if you will, to prepare to meditate. So we'll go through that 5 to 6 minute preparation, and then we'll listen to a few music as you meditate. If you're able to close your eyes, fantastic. If you're not, try to stare at some point with, you know, a half closed eyes, maybe at a floor or something, so you don't get distracted by it. Sometimes when you sit in nature, hearing the birds, the noises around you of life, feeling the wind, you don't quite feel the connection. This chaos within you, outside in your mind, and it's hard to find that place where you feel one or you're meditating. And you have to ease yourself into that space. We know what we need to do. We want to do it. We have the ability to do it. But somehow, our mind is not focused enough. It's scattered. How do we lean on nature? How do we reach out to nature to help us? And there are times when it's as simple as just being in nature, and over a period of a few minutes, allowing nature to tune us, if you will, much like a musical instrument that can be externally tuned in. So if we were to explore this possibility and enter this as an experiment, can we hear the various noises, be aware of our breath, and find a way to connect with all that is outside of us and also within us? If you wish to explore that and join me in this experiment, receive from nature. Draw in a breath. It's okay to feel a little greedy and take in a deep breath, maybe more than you normally take in. But the beauty is you will give back out whatever you took in. You don't hold anything back. A great lesson that nature teaches us. Give back at least as much as you take. And take in as many breaths as you need. And with each breath, consciously let go initially of what you may physically be holding, muscles that might be tight,
doesn't matter the time of day, whether it's the first thing in the morning, or midday, or the end of your working day. As you inhale, draw in nature's energy, the oxygen, life, hope, possibilities. And release doubts, negativity, fear, anger, and of course, at the core, our sadness and disappointment that it is so. And hear sounds of nature that remind you that everything coexists. The pain amidst the sorrow. Order that is possible from chaos. The silence of meditation within the sounds around us. Slowly tune in to that part of you that's quieter, that's witnessing all of the sounds around you. And attempt to hear the quiet that's within you that resonates with the calm around you. And as we enter meditation and listen to a soundtrack, memorize this feeling. And remember, we all have the power to lean on nature, our surroundings, people, and draw from their strength to create a joint strength. Mm-hmm.
beautiful music. This is what Raman had choreographed, composed. It's not a song that exists. It is an out expression of his happiness. This is his service and contribution to the world as we go through such difficult times now. And he's called it happiness. And of those of you who may have missed our inaugural session, the very first session, you can also see it on the playlist. I just want to show you a couple of slides about Mr. Raman's work. The very first session that we had on May 25th, Memorial Day, it's the number one video on our playlist. And we covered why is music, especially Indian music, the raga, the tampura, what is it that is so special? Why does it evoke and how does it evoke this meditative experience in us? And Raman is the artist that I would primarily feature in that segment of music. He's a beautiful performer and has his own music meditation CDs and a website. You can also learn how to play it. And as a wonderful human being, if you do want to also meet with him. And this is what we did in that particular session. So before we move on to the next session, in terms of who is our guest presenter today, we have on tap for you a delightful presentation on traditional and science-based introduction to meditation. An inspirational, motivating human being. Dr. Stephen Parker, Stoma. He is a disciple of Swami Rama of the Himalayan tradition, and he was initiated by Swami Vedabharati in 1971. You see Dr. Parker's tremendous resume, if you will, and this is an abbreviated version of it. A scholar in Sanskrit. He's also a clinical psychologist, a licensed psychologist, practicing psychologist. He is an experienced registered yoga teacher with the Yoga Alliance. He's in the board of director that shapes yoga and yoga studies. He teaches yoga and meditation. He's also a teacher in Rishikesh at Swami Rama Sadhaka Gram Ashram, goes there periodically to run classes. He's a senior faculty in the Himalayan yoga tradition, teachers training program, prolific presenter on topics of yoga, meditation, psychology, spiritual practice. He's written numerous books, and book chapters. His special area is, of course, he's edited Swami Veda's scholarly work on the Yoga Sutras. And the book, the cover of the book that I have there, Clearing the Path. The yoga way to a clear and pleasant mind, linking Patanjali, neuroscience, and emotion in some ways, an integration of all aspects of him, the yogi in him, the scholar in him, the scientific mind, and above all, the healthcare provider, the mental health, clinical psychologist that he is in, that he serves humanity. So without further conversation, I'd like to introduce and welcome Stoma, as I call him, Dr. Parker, into our show.
Right. Namaste. My name is Dr. Steve Parker. I'm also known by my Vanaprastha name as, my initiate name is Stoma. I'm not sure what introduction Barnaji has given, but let me just say that I'm a disciple of Swami Rama of the Himalayas, a student of Swami Rama and his disciple Swami Vedabharati for the last just shy of 50 years. I'm a certified yoga therapist in addition to being a yoga teacher trainer. And also as a psychologist, I had a private practice for 35 years and have been a professor of psychology in a couple of different graduate programs in Minnesota. And so I come to the practice of meditation from several different angles simultaneously, both as a practitioner in a traditional sense, with some very good traditional training, and also as a psychologist and neuroscientist. And I wanted to talk to you in this first session about learning simple breath awareness. I think it seems to many people that this is somehow too easy to be very useful. But in fact, it's something that can make an enormous difference in how you live your life. And I want to just say a little bit about that and about the tradition that I come from by way of introduction. The Himalayan tradition of Swami Rama of the Himalayas is a very broad tradition, very broad parampara of the yoga tradition. By parampara, I mean the tradition of direct person-to-person teaching that goes back through disciples and gurus all the way back to who knows how long, to the beginning of creation, if we are to believe the traditional texts. And in the Himalayan tradition of practice, as a practical matter, we think of three different layers in that tradition. The first layer is the Raja Yoga of Patanjali, the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali and the texts that go along with that text, which provide us with training in the ability to concentrate our mind sufficiently and to cleanse our mind field sufficiently to be able to enter into the meditative state of samadhi. The next layer of the tradition, once the mind has really learned how to do that deep meditation, is the Advaita Vedanta of Shankaracharya. With that enhanced ability to concentrate and to do meditation, we can then take the contemplative processes of Vedanta from simply knowing them as an intellectual practice into our heart through the process of bhavana, this very deep practice of saturating your whole being with an awareness of whatever it is that you're contemplating, to the point of eventually in the state of the deep states of meditation, the mind field actually taking the form of the thing you're contemplating all the way up to Brahman, to ultimate, the ultimate ground of being itself, what in Judeo-Christian tradition we would refer to as Yahweh. The third layer of the tradition is the layer of Sri Vidya Samaya tantric practice and the path of Kashmir Shaivism, which contains the science of mantra, which is the primary method of our meditation, especially in the beginning phases. And so gradually over a long period of time, I think for most people, probably a number of lifetimes, people gradually rise through these different levels of practice as you gain more skill and more groundedness and your mind field is successively clarified and purified and stabilized. So that's a brief sketch of the tradition from which I come. I was initiated in 1971 by Swami Veda Bharati have studied with Swami Rama and Swami Veda for a very long time. So I think that's probably enough by way of background. Let me begin talking about breath awareness from the observation that every meditative tradition, no matter what cultural tradition it comes from in the world, begins with the awareness of breath, all of them. And there are good reasons for that in the structure of the human brain and nervous system. And I want to talk for a moment about some of the neural correlates of intentional breath awareness. The practice of meditation in the yoga tradition, as well as in the Buddhist traditions, and there actually is very little difference between these two, even though some theoreticians and some practitioners try to maintain a difference and a distinction between them. They both begin from what the yogis call prana apana anusmriti, or what in Pali, the Pali language of Buddhism is referred to as banapanasati, It's the same word, the same term, and it's the same practice. The conscious awareness of the flow of breath in your nostrils. Now, a number of really interesting things happen when you begin to intentionally follow the feeling of breath flowing in your nostrils. You begin to practice what we call in neuroscience mindful awareness. In the structure of your brain and nervous system, the part in your forehead, just behind the middle of your forehead, is the last part of the brain to evolve. In that regard, you can think of it as the most human part of the brain. It's called the middle prefrontal cortex. And that middle prefrontal cortex is the part of your brain and nervous system that organizes and integrates the rest, the whole of it. Not just the part that's contained within your brain, because what we know now in the latter days of neuroscience is that your whole body really is brain from top to toe. Every organ system in your body participates in the activity of the brain. And so all of that activity, all the input of awareness and knowledge and information is, and all of the organization of our behavior happens through this medial prefrontal cortex, which, footnote to the yoga system, is identified in the yogic system of chakras as the Ajna chakra, the command center chakra. And so the yogis certainly had an intuitive sense of this aspect of neural functioning. So a number of things happen when you stimulate the middle prefrontal cortex. One of them is that you switch on the parasympathetic relaxation system in your nervous system. And this is really important, especially in modern times, because we spend a lot of time, and especially in these days of the disruption of the COVID virus, being stressed out. Our nervous system is biased in the direction of responding to threats. And so it's very easy and automatic for us to initiate a stress response. And for many of us, we end up initiating that many times during the day to the point where we end up being continually activated. Our stress response ends up being continually activated. And there's a real functionality to it being so automatic, because when you confront a deadly threat, you don't want to have to think about how to respond. You need to have some responses, fighting, fleeing, or freezing, ready to go. And so that's part of the reason why the stress system is so automatic. The relaxation system, the relax and rest and restore system part of your nervous system, is something that requires intentionality. You have to decide to relax. You don't have to decide to get stressed out, but you have to intend shifting your attention in order to turn on the relaxation system. Fortunately, once that intention is there, the switch is very easy to find. It's right under your nose, basically. It's just feeling the flow of breath in your nostrils. That's what switches the relaxation system on. And so the parasympathetic branch of your autonomic nervous system immediately begins to relax you as soon as you begin to consciously attend to your breath. This kind of mindful awareness also, from the perspective of yoga, places your awareness in the function of mind that we refer to as buddhi. This buddhi is the purest part of your mind field. It's the part of your mind field that is the closest to the very subtle and spiritual aspect of your functioning in the world. And so this does a couple of things. It helps you actually observe the flow of thoughts and feelings in your mind. For many of us, that flow of thoughts and feelings constitutes our sense of who we think we are. Many people believe that they are their thoughts and feelings. And that's not true. And one way to discover that that's not true is to begin to observe and to notice that thoughts and emotions are something you have, but they're not who you are. And that gives you some freedom to work with those thoughts and feelings in a way that you can gradually change them. And so I think that gives a lot of hope. And actually, in the mental health field these days, particularly in the field of cognitive behavioral therapy, this kind of mindful awareness is a very great assistance to working in cognitive therapy with people. The more you observe your breath in this way, the more this becomes the normal habit of your awareness, the more you develop a number of important positive qualities in your mind and your personality. And one neuroscientist from UCLA, Daniel Siegel, describes these as compassion, both for yourself and others, openness, an ability to just see what is happening and to not block things out, acceptance, an ability to accept whatever you're seeing, which is really an important part of mindful awareness, and love. You become a more loving person. And there's also another thing that happens. As you deepen your mindful awareness, this medial prefrontal cortex also gives you a sensation of joy. Now, this sensation of joy is really interesting because it's really different from pleasure. It's not a pleasure, even though it is pleasant. It's not a pleasure because it doesn't really fulfill a desire in the sense of, say, eating food when you're hungry or making love when you have a sexual desire. It's a different thing than that. It's just a sense of joyful celebration. And it's what we feel when we grow. It's the emotional reward, as it were, for the process of growing and developing as a human being. And that really applies at all levels. It's just as true of a two-year-old who has just learned to walk and who, after taking that first step, goes, "Wah!" as it is somebody who has conquered an important spiritual struggle and risen to a higher level of being. And that same sense of joy is there in that as well. So joy is with us whenever we grow at every level. And the more you cultivate a mindful awareness as your habit, normal habit of mind, the more joyful your mind becomes over time. This is really the way to get a mind that has a baseline of joyfulness to it. And that is a wonderful gift in life. Now, one of the really important things that happens with awareness when you begin to consciously attend to your breath is that it makes the part of your brain and nervous system that carries your conditionings and your habits go into the background. So there's another part of your brain and nervous system, which we refer to in neuroscience as the default mode network, which was discovered in the 1980s. They noticed in doing experiments with an MRI machine where you would give somebody a task and put them in the machine to see what parts of their brain light up. One research group asked the interesting question, which parts of the brain go quiet? And it turns out it was always the same parts. And this series of structures is what's responsible for your habitual sense of self, for the sense of yourself that you have when you're not paying particular attention to anything. Think of it as your brain on autopilot. But it's also your brain driven by all your habits and conditionings. And when you start to consciously pay attention to your breath, that part of your brain and nervous system goes quiet. And the middle prefrontal cortex begins to reorganize that whole system. And so in the process of changing important habits and conditionings that you have, mindful awareness really helps in the process of making that work, even at the practical level of how the neurons reorganize themselves in your brain. So there's a real sense of harmony at this point between the discoveries of contemporary neuroscience and what the yogis have had to say for centuries about how to live your life. And that's why really all systems of meditation and spiritual practice function on the basis of this awareness. Even in the Christian tradition, Jesus said to his disciples a number of times in the New Testament, "The kingdom of God is all around you. You don't see it." What he was asking his disciples to do was to be aware, to wake up to the greater being that was all around them, to the experience of divinity that surrounded them with every step they took. So, when you undertake this simple breath awareness, as I said before, you begin to observe the flow of thoughts and emotions, and you begin to realize that that's not who you are. Just that process alone begins a process of change. You remember in terms of those four qualities that happen with mindfulness, compassion, openness, acceptance, and love. Acceptance was such an interesting aspect of that. And this quality of accepting, once you have observed the flow of thoughts and emotions and you have accepted what is there, you can see how things are going at the moment, then you have a starting point for any process of change. So without that sense of self-acceptance, without accepting yourself as you are this minute, it's pretty hard to change because you don't really have a starting place to work from. So this acceptance is a really important and critical factor of mindfulness. This enhanced capacity for observing your thought processes gives you a greater ability to observe the thought processes that contribute to your emotional distress, particularly the critical voice in your mind, that little voice in your head that's constantly telling you, you know, you should be smarter, you should be thinner, you should be more outgoing, you know, whatever it is. Everybody has something going with that critical voice. And many people think this is the voice of God or the voice of the guru. It's not. When I'm teaching people about this from a spiritual perspective, I tell them, that's the voice of the devil. Don't listen to it. And the way you don't listen to it is to constantly come back to feeling the flow of breath in your nostrils so that that part of your brain goes quiet again. It also really helps with reframing some of the thought processes that go along with having emotions. If you watch carefully the flow of your thoughts and emotions, you begin to notice that they're related to each other and that there are certain ways of thinking that help to sustain your emotions. If you're a very anxious person, for example, you'll probably find yourself saying, what if a lot? You know, what if this happens? And then what if that happens? And then what if this happens? And then what if that? And pretty soon you have a panic attack. And there are lots of other forms of this kind of mental habit that sustain anxiety and depression. And just by observing these things, they automatically begin to change. And one of the things you notice when you start to become mindful is after a while you begin to see how your mind field automatically has a push to self-correct in it. And that is so important. We have an innate, inborn desire to grow and develop. That's part of who we are as human beings and even as biological organisms. And that push to grow and develop extends all the way into our spiritual life. And so the more mindful you become, the more able you are to allow this kind of self-correction to happen. And it's a very thoroughgoing process. And in the next, in this session and in the sessions that follow, we'll learn some initial practices of meditation that I think can really help you a lot to recognize how just by observing things mindfully, you just are really allowing your body, your breath, and your mind to cleanse themselves and to correct themselves and to move in a better and more growthful direction in your life. So let's come down to some initial practice here. I want to make sure that you have some practice to work with before we finish. And what I want to do is just in the beginning is just this simple breath awareness. And you know, for those of you who want to sort of look it up in the source texts, you can look at Sutra 34 of Chapter 1, the Samadhipada of Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. I'll briefly tell you a quick story about a disciple friend of mine named Wolfgang from Germany. He came to see the Gurudev one time, Swami Rama, had a question about a student, and the student had sent him a letter. He came to Swamiji's apartment, but he had forgotten the letter. So when Swamiji came into the room, Wolfgang got up to go and get the letter, and Swamiji said, no, sit down. He said, put out your hands, look up. So Wolf put out his hands and looked up. And here comes the letter floating down out of the air into his hands. So he looks at the letter, and Swamiji says, is that the correct letter? And Wolfgang says, yes. Swamiji, can you teach me how to do that? Because of course, everybody wants to learn about these great yogic abilities. And Swamiji just laughed and he said, son, just refine your breath awareness. All of this will come to you. This is the central truth of the yoga system and really of every system of meditative practice, regardless of the tradition that it comes from. This aspect of breath awareness and its relationship to the mind is a very deep thing with many, many layers and subtleties to it. And the further you go in refining that fundamental process, that's really how you make progress in yoga. It's not a matter of learning advanced techniques and practices. Actually, the more technique there is, the more beginning the student it's intended for. The important practice is this very simple, very fundamental practice. So just sit with your head, neck, and trunk aligned. And by aligned, I don't mean straight as a board. Your spine has a nice natural S curve to it. So just comfortably tuck your chin slightly to lengthen your neck. And as you sit in this way, sitting in a chair or sitting on the floor, whatever's comfortable, just feel the flow and the touch of the breath in your nostrils. Just watch. No need to do anything. Just feel the flow. Even by the time you've taken 3 or 4 breaths, you can feel how the breath is already changing. How it begins to become longer, smoother, and deeper. You just allow these natural changes to continue. Body knows how to breathe. Body carries a memory of how you breathed as a baby. Let that baby breath return to you. You can notice how it's more from your abdomen than your chest. And as your breath becomes smoother, you may notice that your body becomes more relaxed. You can just enjoy this simple sensation of being alive, the gift of life, breath. As you prepare to rejoin the exterior world. Let your mind, part of your mind, continue to keep this feeling, breath flowing in your nostrils, even as your eyes gently open. As much as you can, keep that awareness with you as you move about in the rest of your day. And every time you think of it, when the mind has wandered off and your default mode network critical voice has taken over again, just come back to your breath. Over and over and over and over. Thousands of times. It takes a while to build a habit. Once you start to build it, you'll have a happier mind. You'll have a more open mind, more loving mind. You'll begin to change your personality in a wonderful, positive direction. And if this is all you did by way of your meditation, if all you did was change your habit of mind so that you were aware of your breath most of the time, you would change so much. You would make so much spiritual progress just with that. So feel free to carry this grace around with you through the rest of your day. And I wish you all the best.
Dr. Stephen Parker, Stoma, he will be with us for two more sessions, guiding us on how to incorporate meditation into our life using simple breath awareness. Stomaji is a scholar in Sanskrit, a licensed psychologist, a registered yoga teacher, is on the board shaping the world of yoga teacher training, teaches meditation and yoga, both in the United States and in Rishikesh and Swami Rama's Ashram. Is a public presenter, a writer. It is our absolute honor and privilege to have him guide us, and this is Stomaji's service to humanity, one more service. As you heard him say, and as you heard me reiterate, one of the key components and the aims of this series is to develop the meditation as a habit and lifestyle in each one of us. Even if it starts with a 2-minute breath awareness. And you don't need apps, but they can help sometimes. So if you need guided meditations with music, if you just want to have relaxation and centering in terms of journaling, or you want apps that focus on neuroscience, similar to what Stoma had focused on. These are all these apps, and you have the reviews available on the website noted below. Take a picture of it. So you can work on this between today and the next time we meet. And just to recap what today was about, we started finding the quiet amidst chaos, the guided relaxation. It is available on the playlist in my Ramaswami Aparna YouTube channel. And then this easing into meditation, Mr. Raman's service and offering to all of us. And we heard the first of a 3-part series on traditional and science-based introduction to meditation. Be sure to join us the next time. These are the various presenter affiliations. And of course, if you caught some portion of the show, you weren't able to meditate, or you want to hear it again, you can rewatch this episode on facebook.com Healing Tradition. And then to access this playlist of Indian meditative practices and other playlists of guided meditation, you can go into youtube.com, Ramaswami Aparna, and this playlist. I sincerely hope you will become a regular in our show and watch and join in live, facebook.com/India in USA. This topic is something that takes multiple repetitions to kind of start remembering what it is about. It is my pleasure and honor to be your host and curator of this series. Namaste, and have a wonderful rest of the day and night.